Turn your neighbor, turn to your neighbor and tell them, did you get that? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to the Lamb. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice because we have a choice. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, choose it. Choose life and not death. Glory. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Hallelujah. Let's go to Psalm 103. Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, all my soul. And all that is within me, bless his holy name. All that is within me. All that is within me. Your soul is your mind, your will, your emotions, your imaginations. All that is within you. Bless him. You bless him in the fullness, you get a fullness. You bless him in a partial, you get a partial. Bless the Lord, all my soul, and forget not his benefits. Now, again, when we bless him with all that we that is within us, it puts us in a position where increase of faith has come, doubt has been melted away, and unbelief, and we're willing to receive. It says, bless the Lord, all my soul, and forget not all his benefits. He's got plenty of them. It says, who forgives all your iniquities. So you got to understand, the first thing that's going to interfere with the benefits of being released is sin. Sin. The number one thing that I sense most of the time that interferes with a person is their mouth. They sin with their mouth. They're constantly tripping over their tongue. Who forgives all your iniquities, your sins, things that, and also iniquity is also things that we inherit. So there's a place where you and I got to break off that stuff that we've inherited. Amen. How many of you know what you spoke yesterday, you're inheriting today? Hello? Amen. Who heals all your diseases? Hello? Dis-ease. Dis-ease. You know, the world still thinks addiction is a disease. And people only recognize a disease as some kind of bacterial thing of cancer and something that's constant. No, disease is also the area of disease, the purpose of disease. The reason why there's a disease, because there's a presence of a spirit. It brings a disease. When there's no presence of an evil spirit, there is no disease. There's what? Peace. Because disease is torment. Disease is associated with doubt and fear, unbelief. So when we get rid of the disease of sin, healing comes. And sometimes healing isn't instant. Sometimes we have to walk it out. There's a process of healing. The whole thing is obedience to the process will result in complete healing. Who heals all your diseases. Again, what's the number one thing that interferes it? Our mouth. Verse 4. Who redeems your life from what? Destruction. Who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies. And what's the end result? Who satisfies your mouth with what? Good things. Hello. It goes right back to the beginning then, doesn't it? So that your youth is renewed like the eagle. Has everybody got it? You know, we are in a time right now where there's so much influence to bring stumbling block. Not only is there persecution towards Christians greater than it's been, especially in this country, but there's so much influence of wickedness in every area, through internet, through TV, through even places of work and business, people, you know, I mean, associations. There's so much influence. And one of the things that the enemy's always trying to get us to do is rebel. And there are what I call R factors. And we have an R factor kind of like of walking things out. There's certain R's, but there's an R factor that I want to talk about this morning, because one of the things the enemy wants to do is bring us into bondage. And he brings us into bondage into religion again. Religion, the word religion means bondage. Remember, Jesus never came to bring religion. Amen? Because there's a lot of things that people believe in that are wrong, but they call it religion. Even an atheist has a religion. It's called unbelief. It's still a religion because that's what he believes. Does everybody get it? But it's amazing when they get in trouble, they go, oh, God, help me. Anyways. So there's an area of religion brings bondage. This is the influence. There's the other one is rebellion. Rebellion. In other words, God is desiring that we submit to all things of Him. Amen. When we don't submit to the things of Him, we cannot resist the enemy, can we? So you got religion, rebellion. How about regret? The enemy binds people up because of the things that they've done. But when they repented, it's done and over with, isn't it? Everybody has a tendency to regret what they've done. But we need to turn that regret in the area of a learning experience, not to do it again. Amen? But the enemy will keep you in regret. If he keeps you in regret, oppression comes. How about resentment? People resent. Usually resentment is a fruit of offense. People are easily offended because they're soulish. They're not in spirit. Oh, you offended me. Oh, shut up. Repent, die, and get risen again. Hello? Does everybody get it? Offense is nothing but somebody that's still fighting for their life, trying to protect themselves. Oh, you offended me. Here's a shovel. So we got religion, rebellion, regret, resentment. How about rejection? That's another R, rejection. You know, people look to be rejected. Why? Because they love to be offended. And then they hang around with Mr. and Mrs. Oppression. And then they get really angry. You know what they want? Revenge! Amen. And it just keeps them in a state of bondage. And you know what they're causing them to do? React! Amen. And when people react, they sow to the flesh and they reap corruption. And what this does is it brings restrictions on us. In other words, there's limitations. The enemy loves to put us in a place of restrictions where there's limitations. He doesn't want you to go any further. That's why the word says they're always learning and learning and never come to the truth, because the enemy's infiltrated. Amen? These things bring captivity. Is everybody okay? Matthew 16. Matthew 16. Remember, we don't do Bible studies, we do training sessions. Amen. This is a military operation. One of the things the Lord always wants to do is expose the strategies of the enemy so that we can constantly be alert, sensitive, and willing to respond. Matthew 16, verse 13 says, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? So they said, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. And he said, okay, now, we got the outside information. Let's get the inside information. Who do you say that I am? What was he requiring? Personal relationship. Who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered and said, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And also I say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And that rock means anointing. And what happened? And I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. In other words, the gates of hell. The gates of hell, they can't. In other words, gates open, don't they? Because what draws demonic activity is mankind. By the things that they say and the things that they do, they draw more demons out of hell. So God is trying to release the angels on our behalf and bring heaven. What was his main purpose? He said the prayer. He said, man, pray to your Father and ask him that the kingdom will come on earth as it is in heaven. Why? To combat hell. So he said, look at this anointing I'm going to release is going to be the foundation of the church. The anointing is the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty. I'm going to send my anointing. I'm going to send the anointed one and his anointing to combat the powers of darkness. I'm going to leave you my presence. I'm going to leave you my sword. I'm going to leave you all the weapons to kick butt on the devil. If you'll pay the price. And the price is cooperation. And then he says in verse 19, and I'm going to give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Believe me, the keys of the kingdom of heaven are more powerful than the keys of the car. And I'll give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. That's power. But one of the things that interfere with the authority to bind and loose is sin. Well, nullify. Because if you're bound by sin, you can't give what you don't have. Is everybody okay? Then Jesus commanded his disciples that they should tell no one that he was the anointed one in his anointing, the Christ. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and the religious dudes. And he's going to be killed, but he's going to rise the third day. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord. This shall not happen to you. You can't do this. And Jesus turned around and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. For you are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. I'm telling you, that's one of the problems we have in the kingdom right now. Too many people are more mindful of things of man and not mindful of things of God. And it causes division. And then Jesus said to his disciples, look, if anyone desires to come after me, here it is. Are you ready? You're going to have to deny yourself. You're going to have to constantly walk away from you. And you're going to have to pick up the sword or the cross, and you'll follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will what? Find it. To save your life is an offense to God. It is an offense to him. The moment you seek man's favor and earthly power, you lose favor of God. I'm going to say this again. The moment you seek man's favor or earthly power, you lose God's favor. The mind and will of God is found alone with God. Hello? It's found where? Alone with Him. That's why prayer is so important every morning. That's why it's important that you strike first. It is sin. In other words, if sin is in your life, to bind and loose is inoperative. Now, the Holy Spirit will bring two revelations. He brings a revelation of you and a revelation of God. That's why He comes to what? Convict. He always shows you you. Amen? Believe me, the first thing He doesn't do is tell you about someone else. That's not God. You don't need Him to tell you. You can tell by the fruit. Hello? So He brings revelation of yourself and a revelation of Jesus. I want to, you know, this started in the garden. Does everybody understand? Look at, deception is Satan's greatest weapon, and his power is fear, isn't it? Now, the serpent did not deceive Adam, did he? Amen? Eve deceived Adam. But Adam decided to please his wife and partook. There was a deception there. See, so many people are out to please man instead of please God. Amen. And history repeats itself, doesn't it? Adam decided to please his wife instead of pleasing God. Spouses decide to please one another instead of pleasing God. It always causes division. Does everybody understand that? God must be first no matter what. I always hear people say, well, it's God first, then your family, and then church. Sorry. It's God, God, and God. Then everything else will fall into place. That's not the doctrine I see in this gospel. Amen? Amen. Because if you're truly doing the right thing, you're going to fall into place. Amen. There'll be spiritual position. There'll be divine position. See, we are under, there's a Babylonian system here. Amen? Yes. The earth is run by a Babylonian system. It's Babylon all over. No matter where you go, all over the earth is Babylon. And the fallen angels are still running this place. So you got fallen angels and you have demons. And then you got humans that have been promised things from Satan's kingdom that are now servants of Satan. In fact, we have the head, one of the head honchos, president of the United States. His purpose is to bring down this country. He's evil. People don't even realize that. And so are his associates. They promote evil. Hopefully one day. See, the elite, everybody hears about the Illuminati and all this stuff. They're the most deceived of anyone. Because they think that they're God's gift to mankind. Sorry. The gift to mankind was Jesus. Is everybody okay? Matthew 7. Our factor. Oh, glory. It's amazing in how we're seeing this battle right now in political. You know, people have turned over such to a political agenda that they got to be politically right or you're an outcast. You're a terrorist. You're right, we are terrorists. We're terrorists of Satan's kingdom. That's right. We're armed dangerous. See, we don't have to go kill ourselves and commit suicide. We're already dead. Dead to self. It's amazing to me how blind and dumb people can be. To think killing yourself and killing humans is of God. I mean, how stupid can people be and still breathe? It just doesn't even make common sense that God would be pleased. And how many of these individuals have been rescued from hell and been telling people about what's up? Because what's been promised to them has been a lie. And to promote evil, exhort evil, pet evil, and call good or righteous evil is an offense to God. Even when you and I approve of something evil, it's an offense to God. Amen? In Matthew 7, verse 13, would you read it with me? Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who what? Go in by it. So look at, it's narrow. It's tight. Things are tightening up even more. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life. There are few who what? Who find it. Look at, there are no shortcuts. There's no easy way. No easy way. Jesus paid the price for me and you to enter. The rest of the price is paid by us. So everybody got it. That means it takes cooperation. If we're not willing to cooperate, then we're walking in rebellion. In Matthew 28, oh, glory. Matthew 28 and verse 18. And Jesus came and spoke to the disciples, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make what? Disciples. Make what? That means that discipleship is not a one-time event. Discipleship continues every day of our life. We never stop learning. When you want to stop learning, you have fallen. Because learning causes making new, eating new. To maintain new, you must eat new. Amen? That's one of the things the enemy tries to do. He tries to get us into a stagnant place where we're not growing anymore, where there's no hunger or thirst to grow anymore. That's okay. I got what I'm needed. Yes, I love Jesus. I do this. I do that. But all the cares of the world are still causing restrictions of growing. They put limitations. He said, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Again, discipleship is not a one-time event. It's a continuous. Why? To overcome the influence of worldly technology. See, technology has taken over tremendously. Technology can now be in all places. Worldly technology is promoting wickedness. We haven't, you know, if you think about it, it wasn't until smartphones came into effect where wickedness increased. Why? Because at one time, pornography and things of that degree were only found if dad had books. Or a neighbor got one of them. Because you couldn't go to the store and buy it. You were too young. But now you can just hit a button and everything comes on the phone. And of course you got Facebook where everybody wants to put their face on it. They puckered her lips. Let me show you. That's why it's called flesh book. So the discipleship is continuous to overcome worldly technology. People that serve darkness and lust. So we can constantly walk away from ourself. Amen? Acts chapter 2. Oh, hallelujah. Our factor. Acts chapter 2. In verse 38. Hallelujah. Yes, flesh book. Everybody wants to show themselves. That's all. This is a promotion of self. Hi, my new hairdo. Hi, my new clothes. My new car. Me. Puke. Hallelujah. Would you read verse 38? And Peter said to them, what? Repent, you flesh creature. And let every one of you, what? Be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, for the promises to you and to your children, to all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call. In other words, what's he saying? Look, you need to repent so you can receive power. That's called resurrection power. Why? So we can overcome evil, deceptive influences. 2 Chronicles 7. Second Chronicles chapter 7, verse 13. I guess better start at 12. It says, then the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said to him, I have heard your prayer and I have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. Thank God we don't need to cut any more animals up. We give the sacrifice of praise. When I shut up heaven and there is no rain or command the locusts to devour the land or send pestilence among my people, if my people who are called by my name will what? Humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and what? Heal their land. I believe right now because the Holy Spirit is really bringing conviction and turning people's hearts where they're beginning to intercede more and first strike more and do more warfare, that it's causing a shift. Because what seems to be lack of victory, there's actually a lot more victory than what you realize. Look at CERN. It's been seized. Why? Because of the prayers of the saints. All the elite and Illuminati and all their plans, they're being, the divine intervention has been causing troubles and within themselves. Why? Because all the praise, the Bible says that when all the praise of the kingdom goes up, it causes an ambush to the enemy. And they begin to destroy one another. There is division in their own organization right now. Look at the religious Republican Party right now. There's division within them. You got the Pharisees of religion organizations that are coming against all kinds because they're self-righteous in this area. They call themselves the elect in the area of what they can say and what they can do. They call themselves conservatives, but they're actually religious. They can't even see the will of God. How many of y'all know that God called Nebuchadnezzar his servant? A heathen. God can use anyone. See, but people are so caught up in the area. They're so caught up in what they see, they can't hear. Because there's a person God wants to put in president. And he's not perfect. And he's not religious. It's called God's will. We want God's will person to be in president. Amen? I mean, you got one of the dudes that promotes religion who been caught in gay associations. You got another one who loves whiskey. No, scotch, excuse me. See, people don't know the histories of these people. I'm not going to speak about the other one. God's will be done. Amen. So there's that area where we got to humble ourselves, repent, which means turn. Which again, God is exposing and nullifying Satan's Babylonian agendas. The Pharisee conservatives that carry false doctrine are blinded to the will of God in these last days. The spirit of religion and self-righteousness combats the will of God. Amen? Again, he can use anyone, right? Again, here's this area of our factor. It's, you know, it's a release of a system, the R factor. You know, we got, everybody's ever heard of the RH factor, which is associated with blood, bloodlines, actually. Well, the word says that the life of the flesh is in the blood, isn't it? Amen? Well, there is an R factor of the spirit, and it's one of the first R factors that we talk about. Everybody, before anything can happen, needs to repent. That's the first R factor, isn't it? But there's a purpose of repenting. Amen? That's to be washed by the blood so that the Spirit can have His way. So that He can always keep in me and you resurrection power. Amen. So the first R factor of overcoming the evil influences is, of course, repent, keeping ourselves clean. And then the second part is the R is resurrection, to maintain resurrection power to overcome. But again, if we have sin in our life, if we're touching unclean things, it can't be maintained. If we're not cooperating and we're rebellious, those things will always cause that arena where the power has been nullified. Is everybody okay? Philippians chapter 3. Again, if so many times the only time people get with God is at fellowship. When God says, get alone with me. Get alone with me. Let me tell you, you'll know the will and His mind when you get alone. Is everybody okay? Philippians 3:7. Let's speak it together. But what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for what? Christ. Yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish that I may gain Christ. In other words, he didn't care anymore about all the things that he had. He knew that the Lord was his shepherd. He wouldn't lack anything. He had a position to where he was able to receive, believe, and execute those things. He said, to be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith, that I may what? Verse 10, know him and the power of his what? Resurrection. And the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the what? Resurrection from the dead. Again, we want to maintain that resurrection power. The first thing that we need to do is repent. Repent, turn away, humble. You know, it takes humility. You must humble yourself. And when you sense the things, see, one of the things the Holy Spirit always does is establishes boundaries. People ignore boundaries. They're boundaries of conviction. They're warning boundaries. He says when you get to these boundaries, you step over, repent. When you touch it, repent. That's why the word says, come out from among them and don't touch anything unclean. When you agree with something, you've touched a boundary. If that boundary of agreement offends the Lord, we need to repent quickly and turn away from it. Amen. Why? Because you'll lose the nullifying, the binding and loosing. Your warfare will be nullified. Because sin nullifies everything. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Is everybody okay? So we want to maintain the resurrection power to overcome so we can have continuous victory. Every believer should have continuous victory. In John chapter 1, in verse 11, it says, and Jesus came to his own, and his own did not what? Receive him. They rejected him. Verse 12, but as many as what? Received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. So they received and they believed, didn't they? That means they executed. Who are born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but the will of God. Being willing to receive who we are, we must be willing to receive counsel, correction, and direction. Amen? We must be willing to be chastened. Because the Father loves those. He chastens. And anyone who rejects chastening or correction from the Lord is not his. So we must receive it, believe it, execute it. In other words, do it. Or we're not considered his. In Malachi chapter 3. So we've got repent, resurrection, and receive. Amen? Amen. There's 3 hours. I don't know how many hours we're going to, but whatever hour appears, we'll just talk about it. Malachi chapter 3. Verse 16. Is everybody there? Let's speak it together. Then those who feared the Lord spoke to one another, and the Lord listened and heard them. So a book of remembrance was written before him for those who fear the Lord and who meditate on his name. They shall be mine, says the Lord of hosts. Isn't that wonderful? Those who feared him, reverenced him, honored him, respected him, kept him first. He said, those are mine. Everyone say, I'm his. On the day that I make them my what? Jewels. How many of y'all want to be a jewel of King of Glory? Yeah, you'll be his precious jewel. I will spare them. Hallelujah. So only the jewels get spared, obviously. So don't become coal, all right? Although coal gets crushed, doesn't it? It becomes a what? Diamond. So we were all coals at one time. But you don't want him to come back and be a coal. Because you know where coals get put, right? Fire! Coal. Oh, yeah. He says, they shall be mine, says the Lord, and on that day I'll make them my jewels, and I will spare them as a man spares his own son who serves him. Then you shall again discern, everyone say discern, between righteous and the wicked, and between one who serves God and one who does not serve him. This discernment is called, to discern is to recognize. In other words, we recognize, not justify, by discernment. So discernment allows you to recognize things, doesn't it? And that's the next R, recognizing. Now you can't be, if you're not alert, you won't recognize, will you? And the only way to maintain alertness is to be consistent. So if you're not consistent, it's impossible to be alert. Amen? Discern is to recognize. We recognize and not justify things, but we recognize by discernment. So we use discernment to recognize things. Amen? In 1 John chapter 1. So we got repent, resurrection, receive, recognize. Oh, yes. And what are we always battling? Religion, rebellion, regret, resentment, rejection, revenge, reactions, and restrictions. You'll need to get the CD. So it can go deep. Oh, glory. 1 John chapter 1. Is everybody there? In verse 5. This is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light, and in him is what? No darkness. So there's no gray areas, is there? None. If we say that we have fellowship with him and we walk in darkness, we lie. That's amazing to me. That needs to be put on billboards. Because there's a lot of people, so-called believers out there, that are walking in darkness. And they say, oh, we have fellowship with him. Yeah, we meet him at the bar. We meet him at Fleshbook. Hello. Verse 6, read it with me. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Yes. All sin. Let's go to 1 John 3. Those that practice truth and not political correctness or carnal approval. Amen? People are more concerned about what man thinks about them than God. Verse 4, 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4. Whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. And you know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him there is no sin. Whoever abides in him does not sin. Hello. In other words, if we're truly abiding in him, we have dominion, don't we? Amen. Why? Because resurrection power is always overcoming sin. So sin doesn't dictate our decisions. It doesn't mean you won't make a mistake, but it will not overcome you. Never. Sin never will overcome you if you're truly walking in this way. He who abides in him is not overcome by sin. Whoever sins has neither seen him nor known him. People walk away from him and forget him. Verse 7, read it with me. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Hello. Whoever has been born of God doesn't sin. For his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he has been born of God. In this, the children of God and the children of the devil are manifest. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is he who does not love his brother. Wow. So there's a difference. He says, man, people practicing righteousness maintain resurrection power, and they were able to resist evil. Has everybody got it? They're able to what? Resist evil. James 4. So let's see, we have repent, resurrection, recognize, or receive. And now we're going to go to resist. We're not going to resist chastening. Amen? We're going to accept chastening. We're going to accept counsel, correction, and direction. James chapter 4, is everybody there? Let's see, in verse 6. Read it with me. But he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud. 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 Pride is the number one thing that protects self. That's why people get offended, because they're so full of pride. But he gives grace to the humble. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Hello. So we want to resist the devil, don't we? But if we're not practicing righteousness, we're not maintaining the resurrection power, and we can't resist the devil. Again, the only way to maintain the resistance of the evil and maintain resurrection power is to submit to God in all things. Has everybody got that? Not according to the will of man, not according to the emotions of man, but according to the will of God. Resist the devil so you don't react. You respond, and you respond by what is written. It is written. Why? Because you're releasing the sword of the Spirit to battle, aren't you? Amen? Ooh, that's a good one. So we've got now, are you ready? Repent, resurrection, receive, recognize, resist, respond. 2 Timothy 4. Second Timothy chapter 4. The R factor. You know, there's a word called rebuke. The Lord says, those who are unruly, rebuke in the presence of all. Hallelujah. Verse 1, would you read it with me? I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will what? Judge the living and the dead as appearing in his kingdom. What does he say? Preach the word. Be what? Ready. In season and out. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own little desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers because they like sin. And they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. But you be what? Watchful in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist and fulfill your ministry or your calling. In other words, there's something about what God is saying. He says, in this area, when we are spiritually positioned, and resurrection power is within us all the time. And it's just overcoming, always overcoming sin, always overcoming influences, overcoming lust, overcoming things, love of money, love of self, love of the world, overcoming these things all the time and always maintaining Christ first, no matter what. There's a heart that establishes, and it's called a heart of rescue. A heart of what? Rescue. Why? Because you want to rescue everyone else. But you know, you and I can't do it. But so we bring the rescuer with us, because he who's in us is greater than he is in the world. So our intention now is no longer self-motivated. It's eternal motivated. And when there's an eternal motivation and a constant, you're in position. When there's not an eternal motivation, you know you're out of position. Amen? Well, we want to be rescued. We want to rescue people from religious false practices and the snare of the devil. So they can be ready in season out. So they can walk in truth and power. Revelation chapter 2. So we got resurrection. Now we got repent, resurrection, receive, recognize, resist, respond, rescue. Ready, rebuke, We could go on forever on the R factor. It's an eternal thing. Revelation 2. Is everybody there? Praise God. Verse 1. Let's read it together. And to the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things says he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your labor, your practice, and that you cannot bear those who are evil. And you have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them to be liars. Amen? Verse 3. And you have persevered and have patience, and have labored for my name's sake, and have not become weary. Nevertheless, this I have against you, that you have left your what? First love. Left first love. Verse 5. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, and what? Repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. But this you have, that you hate the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Amen? Now, one of the things he's saying then is return. Return what? To your first love. When you begin to drift, he's no longer your first love. Some of us have never really made him our first love. We've made everything else our first love. Return to your first love. And I'm going to close at 1 Corinthians 3. So we got repent, resurrection, receive, recognize, resist, respond, rescue, return, and you know what you get? A reward. First Corinthians chapter 3. You know, the Bible tells us that after you do the will, the promises are released. When God asks you to do something, he's always trying to release something to us. So as you apply what he said to do, and you do it according to his will and not our own. Because, see, some people will take what God has told them to do, but they'll do it in an ungodly way. Amen. They'll cheat, lie, steal, all kinds of goofy things. Grumble, complain, all of this stuff. Which, of course, their mouth, their tongue makes them bring sin. So when God tells you to do something, it's not according to our perspective of understanding, is according to his character and integrity. Amen? 1 Corinthians 3 and verse 9. Is everybody there? Let's speak it together. For we are God's workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. According to the grace of God, which was given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another builds on it. But let each one take heed how he builds. For no other foundation can another one lay that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with what? Gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clearer, for the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on endures, he will receive a what? A reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet is through fire. Do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him, for the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. Let no one deceive himself. Let no one do what? Deceive himself. If anyone among you seems to be wise in this age, let him become a fool that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, he catches the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile. Therefore, let no one boast in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or world or life or death or things present or things to come. All are yours. And you are Christ, and Christ is God's. The R factor. The whole thing revolves around resurrection power, doesn't it? That's what we want to maintain. Why? It's the only way we overcome. That's how Jesus overcame everything, resurrection power, and so do you and I. Amen? But sin nullifies everything. Touching and agreeing, things that we speak, things we agree with our thoughts, sin will nullify it. That's why he says, examine yourself. We want eternal motives, don't we? Not selfish motives. We need to examine our motives and our intents in everything we do so it keeps us positioned. Amen? Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. Again, we protect the seed with the blood of Jesus. We ask it to grow and bear fruit for your glory. Bring healing to each and every one. Bring revelation and impartation to your people. And prepare our hearts for communion, that we may receive, believe, and execute according to your will, in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen. Amen. Praise God. So prepare your hearts for communion. You may bring your tithes and offerings up.